Hey church, big welcome. Happy Sunday. It is October 24th. I hope that you have been crunching leaves. Yes. As the weather is beginning to just change over. I know I've been enjoying this weather, even though it's been hot and cold.
Yeah, moody. Tulu, it's been very moody.
It has been very moody.
Like, you don't know what you're going
to
get.
No, it's like you have to prepare. I love this time of the year because you leave your house with a jacket or a hoodie.
Yes.
And then you take it off. So you have like an outfit for that.
Yes.
And then when you take off your hoodie or jacket, it's like you still got to boom.
Yeah.
And there, it's fall.
And the worst is sometimes like you just have like if you look at the forecast, you think through what you're going to do and you walk outside and you immediately have outfit regret because you're like, oh, no, I'm going to be too hot or I'm going to be cold. I'm going to be absolutely too cold.
Let us know if you're in the chat, if I'm going to be very vulnerable and honest right now, if you have ever experienced what I call the train sweats.
Oh, because the train sweats.
It's just like, it's cool, then it's hot, and then I'm just there like sweating in the train, praying that it's my stop to get off just to feel cool.
Yes.
But hopefully that wasn't too much for you. But let us know if you have ever felt that in the chat. Say hello from where you're from.
Yeah.
We are here in the studio in New York, but hello to Boston, Connecticut, New Jersey, and New York. We are so excited that you're here with us this morning, or if you're watching on demand across those four states or beyond, big welcome.
Yeah, thank you so much for making the time to spend with us. We know that it's going to be an amazing and beautiful service, and we're going to start off with worship. And I just love it. It takes us a moment. We're just going to step back and acknowledge God for who He is. Yeah. And I just love the transformational power of worship. And let me just pray for us. I pray that we're able just to cast our anxieties aside and just enter this place with thanksgiving and still our hearts as we worship Him. Father, we just thank You so much for this day. We thank You for this time that we can gather and thank You and acknowledge You for who You are. Lord, I pray, Lord, that You just prepare our hearts and our minds for what You have in store for us in this service today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, church, let's worship.
Oh, You're doing a new thing. You're doing a new thing. Oh, yes. Oh, my Lord.
I am so thankful that God is continually doing a new thing. And I just pray that he continues to open up our eyes to see the incredible things and wonders that he is performing around us. And I also love that he never gives up on us. Like my spirit was being lifted as I was hearing and singing that. God never gives up on us. The power of his love is just all encompassing and powerful. And I love that we can bring our prayers to him because he loves us so much. God says, hey, you can cast your cares on me and I'm going to take care of it. And Diana here, we have some prayer requests in my hands from our church family. Diana, she's praying for healing from lupus. And John, he's praying for a speedy recovery from an accident. And Stephanie is praying to find the right apartment. And I just encourage you, if you have any prayer requests right now, you can follow the information on the screen or just drop it in the chat if you're joining us for the 10 a.m. service. And our team would love to pray along with you. We just want to storm heaven and pray and battle in prayer for the things that you're believing for. So I'm just going to pray for us right now. Father, we just thank you so much. Father, we thank you that no task, no prayer, nothing is too big for you. Nothing is impossible for you, Lord. And I pray, Lord, for those that are believing for healing right now. Lord, Father, our friend that's believing for healing from lupus. God, I pray, Lord, that you would be with every doctor, every nurse, every test, every scan, Lord. And we pray for a full recovery and healing from it, Lord. And I pray for those that are believing for job, Lord, Father, opportunities. I pray, Lord, that you would just open the right doors. And I pray for a divine favor as people step into interviews and submit applications, Lord. And I pray for just the prayer requests that are coming through the chat right now, God, and even the unspoken ones, Lord, that you know. Lord, may you just begin to move and work in the way that only you can. Father, we thank you so much. We thank you in advance, Lord God, for what you're going to do. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing right now. And we thank you for what you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. I love, Tolu, when you said we thank you in advance because we know what Jesus is going to do. And with that, we have some praise reports, knowing that God is going to do something. Yeah. And then people send these praise reports in. And if you have any praise reports that you want to send of what God is doing in your life, please text the word praise to 84,000, where we would love to read them. We would love to just celebrate Jesus alongside you for what he's doing in and through your life. But we have Vivian here who finally got accepted into grad school. That is wonderful. That is awesome. We're cheering you on. Good luck and praying for help for the sleepless nights of study and writing your paper and dissertation and all the good things that come with grad school. Again, praying for you. Tulu, you're in grad school right now.
I am. I need to finish that thing up.
Okay.
I'll take prayers.
We'll take prayers and thanks in advance.
Okay, for all, I like all that. Thanks happening. In advance. For
and Larissa, who just got her first job in healthcare, and that is so awesome. Yeah. We're congratulating you in your first job in the field that you want. And I have a praise report that I want to share. I just wanted to be able to praise two awesome volunteers in our church, Alex and Jorge. I was able to sit in our premarital course that we do that's still going on. And I sat in last week, and you guys just do a fantastic job. And I just wanted to be able to praise you and all the good things that Jesus is doing through you for the couples who are getting married and are married in our church that come by your hand. So big thank you to Alex and Jorge, who are just faithful pillars in our church.
I love them. They've been here since like day one, building this house brick by brick. They're just incredible. We love you, Alex and Jorge.
I love them so much. And church, we want to let you know about a significant date that's coming up. November 6th and 7th, we are going to be in person and online for our Heart for the House weekend. Heart for the House is something that we do once a year where we pray and we plan to figure out actually what we want to be able to sacrifice and give above and beyond for the vision of this house. And over the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at and talking about what we're actually going to be giving to, which which is going to be super exciting to figure out what we give to globally, what we're going to do locally, and it's just going to be a phenomenal time. So be thinking about that, be praying about that. You could also text one word, H4TH, just a little abbreviation for Heart for the House, to 84,000, where it'll lead you to our website, and you'll see all the initiatives that we are giving to this year, which is exciting. And right now, church, we are going to continue in our worship, and we're going to come around our tithes and our offerings. I love this moment because we get to partake in what Jesus is doing to build his church here locally, globally, from New York all the way up to Boston. We get to partake in that. So right now, if you're ready to give, I want to encourage you, maybe text the word give to 84,000. And as you do that, or click in the link in the description. But right now, I want to invite one of our faithful volunteers up. His name is Anu, and he's going to share around our offering. Anu, come on up.
Thank you.
What's up, bro? You good?
I'm great.
Awesome.
Great. How's it going, church? I'm really excited to encourage you around our generosity. So I'm going to be reading from John 6, from verse 5, and it says this: Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, "Where can we buy bread to feed these people?" He was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." Then Andrew spoke up and he said, "There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what good is that with this huge crowd?" Now, if you continue to read on, you'll see that Jesus takes that bread and the fish and does the miraculous with it and feeds the greater crowd. But whenever I read that, I'm super encouraged by the act that precede that extraordinary moment. See, I could imagine that Andrew would have walked around asking people, "Hey, do you have anything to contribute? Do you have anything that you can share with people?" And people would have probably said, "No." Some people would have said, "No, I do, but I kind of need to eat it for my family and take care of my people." But when he gets to this young person is willing to give what he does have. Now, I would also imagine that this young person had a crew with him. After all, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish is a lot for one person to eat, even if you're me and, 6'6" and all that. But he probably had a crew that he had to feed. But he was willing to say, "I'm going to be bold in my generosity, and I'm going to play a part in the bigger picture here. I'm going to play a part in feeding and taking care of this crowd." See, church, that's what we get to do in this moment. We get to be bold in our generosity. We get to play a part in a bigger picture of taking care of our city, taking care of our youth, taking care of all the different communities that we get to be a part of. You see, we don't do this because of the amount of what we have to give or what we want to give. We do it because we trust the person that we're giving it to. We trust what we're giving it to. We're trusting that God takes whatever it is and does something miraculous with it. You see, this young person came he came prepared. He had something. He had more than enough that was for him and his people. So it's not about the size of it, but it was about, "I'm going to be bold and trust you, Lord. I'm going to be bold and trust that you'll take care of everything." So Lord, I just want to encourage you here today that whatever it is you do have, whatever it's the big or the small, trust it and trust it with Jesus. Trust that he would do something bigger than you can imagine, something that will have a ripple effect across our communities, across our city, across this nation. So I'm just going to pray for you as you prepare to give. Father God, we just thank you for every gift, every giver. We thank you for the opportunity to partner with you to take care of our city, to take care of our family, to take care of the people around us, Lord. We ask that you would continue to show us how to be generous. Lord, would you give us the boldness to step out even when we feel like we don't have enough, or even when we feel like we're not where we need to be to give what we can. Pray that you would encourage us and you would continue to teach us how to step forward and be who you called us to be in these moments. And it's in your powerful name we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks for that, Anu. That was incredible. I love that thought of being bold and trusting in God. And once again, thank you so much for those of you that are sowing week in and week out into what we're doing here. So I'm excited today. Pastor Krishan Jayaratnam is going to be bringing an incredible word, and I think it's just going to bolster your faith and encourage you. But right before that, we just want to show you a quick video. A Heart for the House is coming upon us, and I'm really looking forward to it. You know, Terry Crist, he shared an incredible message last week, and he said something that really stuck out to me. He said, sow into the future that you want to see. And that's what I love about Heart for the House, is giving us an opportunity to sow into the future of this church as we rebuild, to sow into the vision as we rebuild this house. So we're going to show you a little bit of snippets every week, showing you into what we're going to be sowing into as a church collectively into Heart for the House. So check out this video. And then after that, Pastor Krishan is going to bring an incredible word.
Hillsong Africa Foundation's core purpose is to build lives that build a nation. When COVID-19 restrictions came into place last year, Hillsong Africa Foundation shifted their major focus to emergency relief, food security, and distribution.
Through the support that we have received and our partnering with other local organizations, we have given out over 5 million meals over the last 12 months.
As South Africa continues to grapple with a high number of COVID cases, Hillsong Africa Foundation will focus on providing support to community organisations, families and individuals devastated by the pandemic.
Hi church, we are here at Yankee Stadium, home of the New York Yankees. We won't spend too long talking about the recent encounter with the Boston Red Sox. Now, I'm figuring out a few things about America and about New York, one of which is I probably shouldn't be cheering for the Boston Red Sox as a New Yorker, but I'm figuring these things out. It's taking a little bit of time. Plus, I love Boston so much, so what am I gonna do, right? There's a lot to figure out. We're gonna figure out how to say things in a different way, to be understood, even getting an order across in a shop. I've gotta start to change how I communicate. I figured that a whole lot of us in Australia seem to have dropped the R's from most of the words that we say. So over here, I've started to realize you've gotta pronounce things with R's. Who knew? But water. The R gets pronounced at the end, whereas in Australia, you just say water. Just water, mate. You know, there's no need for all of these extra R's being pronounced everywhere. You get even a guy that's named Robert. We don't pronounce the R, we just call him Bob. We'll get out of pronouncing an R any way we can. And so we get a little bit teased for that. But I have realized that in New York, you might not pronounce, you know, I mean, you might get your R's right here, but you do other things like add in letters that aren't really there. Like, we normally go get a coffee in Australia, but I guess we get a coffee. There's a W. I don't know where the W came from, but it's there. I hear it all the time. In Australia, we have dogs. Over here, you got a dog. There's a W in there. It just appeared. It didn't have any place there beforehand, but it's there now. So I've got to pronounce some things that I didn't used to. I got to add some things in that I've never known before, or I just got to stick with my Australian accent. Either way, I've been thinking about all the ways in which we figure those things out. Because for me, when I grew up in Australia, I grew up in two worlds. I grew up in a Sri Lankan home, and I grew up in Australia. It meant that there were ways we pronounced things in my household that when I pronounced it like that in a schoolyard, I pretty quickly figured out I'd gotten it wrong. The most embarrassing thing for me growing up was how I pronounced V's and W's and the emphasis on certain words. I mean, I would say that I went and took some vitamins this morning, but really I should have been saying I had vitamins this morning. And you only need to do that once or twice, and you pretty quickly realize by the laughter and the teasing of the people around you, the mistake that you have just made. You know, I have a whole history of mispronouncing those kinds of things. And when you're young, especially when I was young, that stuff can rock your confidence. It can make you feel like you're not included. It can help position you on the outside of something. And I can remember all of that stuff knocking about how I felt in school. It was interesting because I was opening my mouth to try and communicate something that I feel I was meant to do, something that I believe, I hope is a gift upon my life, something that I know I'm meant to walk in. And yet in the very thing that's meant to be a strength, there were all kinds of challenges coming against me. I don't know if you've ever been there. I can remember when I first started preaching. And I was communicating on a Friday night at our youth program. Shout out to all of the young people in our church. And I can remember getting up to communicate, and I got off the platform that day and I knew I hadn't nailed it. I knew I'd made a bunch of mistakes. I knew it wasn't as strong as it could have been. I got off the platform and I was just feeling the worst. I walked up to my youth pastor at the time, Lucinda Dooley, who leads our church in South Africa with her husband, Phil. I walked off the platform. I remember walking straight up to Lucinda and saying, I did such a bad job. That just didn't nail it. I missed the mark by such a long way. And Lucinda told me a couple of things. She said, one, there's always next week. And she said, two, the enemy will always try and attack your strengths. The enemy will always try and attack your strengths. I mean, it's one thing when we get it wrong in something that we already know is a weakness. I mean, I want to get better at those things. I want to get stronger at those things. But when we make those mistakes and we believed that it was a strength, what happens next when something that was meant to be a strength, when something that is a gift, when something that is a talent, when something is on our life to be able to bring into the world of our community and our family and our workplace, what happens when those things become challenged? And we start to question whether our strengths are even a strength anymore or whether it is a weakness. When those things start to take place, then all of a sudden, we start to question whether we should bring that strength into our family, whether we should offer that strength in community, whether that strength has a place in our purpose. I don't know if you've ever been there. You've made mistakes that you just can't fix. I don't know if you've ever been there. You've faltered at the finishing line. I don't know if you've ever been there and you've been called out by people and you've had someone write a letter to your senior pastor to let them know how disappointed they were with your message, or you've encountered someone that's started to have a go at you online. Whether it's unfair critique or whether it's challenges we need to grow through, whether it's feedback that we need to take on, we can face this kind of opposition that causes us to question our strengths and lose our confidence. As a pastor, I've noticed in the lives of many people in this season that it's been a season in which we have had every opportunity to lose confidence. I want to speak to us today, and especially for those who have lost confidence in areas of their life. I mean, it's been a season. It's been a year. I've got a friend of mine. He works in the orchestra. In his work in the orchestra during COVID meant that they had to practice and stay up to date with all of that from home. And so there was a whole lot that they were trying to do as an orchestra. There were a whole lot they were trying to get their head around, and people are practicing their instruments at home. But he told me, when you get back to being in a room and performing for people, there's an energy and there's an intensity with which you play that meant that people in the orchestra are getting injured. People that haven't performed in front of people for over a year are starting to feel intimidated. I don't know what it is that you are walking into or walking back into in this season, but I have observed time and time again a lack of confidence. I want to speak today about a crisis of confidence and a stirring of faith. A crisis of confidence and a stirring of faith. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 4, it says this, "Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith." Look at the proud, their spirit's not right, but the righteous live by faith. Look at the proud, they're not right, but those that are right live by faith. It sets up this opposition between pride and faith. Because when we're proud, we have this pride in ourselves and in our own ability. And isn't that the way that we are taught to have confidence? If you can have confidence in yourself, if you can have confidence in your own ability, if you can have confidence in what you can accomplish, if you can have self-confidence, then you're going to make it. Then you're going to have the confidence that you need. But I want to suggest that sometimes when our confidence is just in ourselves, just in our own ability, just in our own capacity, then we start to move towards pride, and a pride that is just in ourselves and in our own ability can lose sight of the faith that we are called to have. Can be rocked by the challenges that come our way, can be threatened by the mistakes that we make. But when our faith is in something different, not just in ourselves, then all of a sudden, when we have those moments where we make mistakes, like we all will, when we have those moments where we fail, like we all will, then it doesn't have to rock and shake our world and cause a losing of confidence, a loss of confidence. But we can move forward in faith, have confidence in the midst of challenge, have confidence in the midst of making mistakes, have confidence in the midst of failure, because our confidence wasn't just in ourselves anyway. Look at the proud. There's something not quite right. Look at those who are right. They live by faith. A crisis of confidence and a stirring of faith. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 30 to 39, we're going to take a moment and read this passage together. I'm sorry, it is a little bit of a read, but I think it's worth us taking the time today to have a look at what the Bible is saying. And it says this, "For we know the one who said," let me bring it up, "For we know the one who said, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God.' But recall those earlier days when, after you had been enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to abuse and persecution, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion for those who were in prison, and you cheerfully accepted the plundering of your possessions, knowing that you yourselves possessed something better and more lasting. Do not therefore abandon that confidence of yours. It brings a great reward. For you need endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet, in a very little while, the one who is coming will come and will not delay, but my righteous one will live by faith. My soul takes no pleasure in anyone who shrinks back, but we are not among those who shrink back and so are lost, but among those who have faith and so are saved. A crisis of confidence and a stirring of faith. This letter is written to a population, a community that have seen some persecution before, have seen challenge before, have had their livelihoods and their lives threatened, have been threatened with imprisonment, and some in their number were. It's written to a congregation, and the best guess we have is that it's a church or a community in Rome. And they faced one bout of persecution where people were ejected out of the city for being Christians, where they lost their possessions, where they were in prison. And best we can guess, this letter is written just at the point where Nero is about to begin, or has maybe just begun, a fresh round of persecution against the church, and the fires that ravaged Rome he is starting to blame on the Christians and scapegoat them as being responsible. And just as this persecution is starting to uptick, the writer is saying to them, hey, it's tempting in this moment because persecution is coming. It's tempting to think it might be easier to go back to the old ways of thinking. It might be easier to go back to an old religion. You've left a way of thinking that said, if I just do everything in my own strength, if I just do everything I can do in my own capacity, then that means that I'm going to be able to step in to a right relationship with God. You've left that way of thinking behind, and you've instead started to stand in faith on what Jesus has done for you. You've moved from a faith in your own ability to a faith in Jesus and His ability. You've moved from a faith in your own rightness to a faith in Jesus's rightness, Jesus's righteousness. And he's saying it's tempting when persecution comes to think, I'm going to go back to my old way of thinking about this. But then he reminds them, remember what happened last time? Remember how you resolved it? Remember how you moved through it? Remember how you stood fast in the midst of it? Remember what took place last time? And sometimes it's interesting for us to remember just a little bit of our own history. Many times that we face challenge, many times that we face opposition, it's not our first rodeo. It's not the first time that we have faced some challenge. It's not the first time we face some opposition to our strengths. And sometimes we just need to remember, and he's encouraging them to remember, you have been here before. You have done this before. You've made it through before, and what helped you do it then is going to help you do it now. Hold fast to that confidence of yours. There's a few things in this passage that I think can really help us as we believe that we can have a stirring of faith that's going to result in a godly confidence. Not the type of confidence that comes just from being confident in ourselves, but a godly confidence. What does a godly confidence look like? Well, I think that the faith that we read about in this passage can help us to have that kind of godly confidence. The first thing that stands out that's good for us to hear is that we need faith in God's good judgment. We need faith in God's good judgment. Right at the outset, the writer is talking about God's judgment. And normally we think about that in terms of punishment. We think about that in terms of something that's punitive. I've made a mistake, I'm going to be punished. God's going to bring his judgment and he's going to punish me. When we read about Jesus, it says that he proclaimed the day of the Lord, and the day of the Lord was concerned with God's good judgment. It was good news and it concerned God's good judgment. So how can we think about judgment in ways that are conducive to building our confidence and not causing us to live in a kind of debilitating fear of punishment? I believe that we're called to think about judgment in different terms to just a courtroom, in different terms to just what kind of punishment is going to be meted out. You see, we think about judgment in positive terms all the time, in terms of exercising good judgment when it comes to how you use your time, exercising good judgment when it comes to how late you're gonna stay up binge watching that show. Ouch, was that a little bit too close to home? Exercising good judgment in what kinds of boundaries you place on the usage of the devices that are invading your world. We're encouraged and we're aware of what it means to exercise good judgment, and we can have faith in God's good judgment. In Thomas Long's commentary on this passage, he says this: "We must be careful not to hear such language through the mouthpiece of 1,000 petulant hellfire and brimstone sermons. In the scripture, the judgment of God is good news, a sign that God's love for the world will allow nothing to stand that will harm or destroy. The idea of judgment does not convey a picture of a peevish God who gets mad at sinners and strikes out in retaliation. Rather, God exercises good judgment. God's judgment sets things right and repairs the broken creation." I don't know about you, but I'm believing for that kind of good judgment. I have faith for that kind of good judgment, that it has arrived with the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, that it will be completed one day, that God is going to bring good judgment into our worlds, that God is going to bring good judgment into the world, into all of creation. He's going to set it up to be everything that it was made to be. I have faith in God's good judgment. The second thing is this: we need faith that's seen in compassion. Faith that's seen in compassion. We're told that the last time they went through this kind of persecution, it resulted in compassion for those that were in prison. Rather than responding in fear that they might be imprisoned, rather than responding in a way that caused them to draw back, they actually put themselves on the front line and stood with those who also were in prison and had compassion upon them. Rather than withdrawing in fear, they started a prison ministry. What a way to respond to the challenges they were facing as a community. And the writer is encouraging them. This is how you responded in the past, and let compassion again be the fruit of your confidence in the future. You know, as we read through this passage and as we read through the Gospels, it becomes striking the number of times that we encounter this word compassion. In fact, over and over again, before Jesus is working miracles, before Jesus is speaking powerful words, before Jesus is moving in the lives of people, we encounter this word compassion. Jesus is moved by compassion. He is constantly motivated, directed, and allows the power of God to be at work through him because of compassion. I pray that if we are going to move in the kind of confidence that God has for us, it would be reflected in compassion. It wouldn't just be a confidence that's focused in on ourselves, but allows us to focus in on others and see people with compassion. Number three, faith that brings a joy in knowing something better and more lasting. Faith that brings a joy in knowing something better and more lasting. The writer, and I keep saying the writer rather than using the name because we don't know who wrote Hebrews. But the writer says to the people, hey, not just have you've been there before, but he says to the people that last time this happened and your possessions even were plundered, rather than responding with outrage at what had happened, you responded with joy. Now, this seems like a strange reaction to us, But what had taken place was as their possessions had been plundered, it caused them to remember and realize that ultimately their faith isn't in their possessions and that they really possess something already that is far greater, that is more lasting, that can't be stolen from them. They have a reward in the age to come that far surpasses anything they can try and cling to in this present age. And as they were reminded of that, it caused them to have joy. Do we live in that kind of joy? Knowing that the imperfections of the present point us towards the joy that is to come, is a reminder that it won't always be like this and that we possess something that is better and more lasting. I don't know what has been taken. I don't know what is missing. I don't know what is not present that you are dreaming for and longing for, but I do believe there is an age to come. And if we would have our faith in that age, that reward, what is going to be brought to completion, we can have a joy in the midst of trying circumstances. I know sometimes when we face loss, the loss of a loved one, the loss of people in our world and in our family, it doesn't seem right or appropriate to respond with joy, and I have been there. Certainly, I know that we are called to weep with those who weep, let alone to be able to experience sadness and grief ourselves. That kind of joy isn't just about covering over the things that have been devastating in our lives, but we can have a confidence, even in the midst of grief, even in the midst of sorrow, even in the midst of the worst kind of loss, that there is an age to come. And in that age to come, He will wipe away every tear and will have the opportunity to be reunited in something that is better and more lasting. I pray that we would continue to have that kind of faith in what is better and what is more lasting than what we experience and possess here in this age. The fourth thing is this: faith needs endurance. Faith needs endurance. And that word endurance can have some really negative connotations. We have to endure under hardship. We have to endure under challenge. But when we think about it, it has a sporting connotation here. An endurance, speaking about athletes that are competing for a crown, as Paul talks about elsewhere. We have this sporting analogy, which is fitting right here at Yankee Stadium. I don't know if you like sport, you dislike sport. I don't know if you're cheering for the Giants or the Jets, or possibly for the only team that actually plays its home games in New York, Buffalo. I don't know what your thoughts are towards sport, but what we encounter here is a connection to athleticism, a connection to sport. And if endurance isn't just about enduring hardship, if endurance, we can start to understand what that means in the context of a contest, then sometimes we can start to see endurance in a fresh light. Thomas Long, again, about this concept, says this: notice what this subtle sports image accomplishes. It refashions their experience of persecution. What looks for all the world like an experience of abuse and mistreatment, public humiliation and plundering, turns out from the perspective of faith to be a contest, an Olympic time trial. This also redefines the word endurance, moving it from a negative experience, look what you had to endure, to an athletic virtue. For you need endurance, transforming it from a bitter description of the abuse they had to stomach to a naming of the strength and conditioning in faith that they received as a result of staying out there on the field. I don't know what your field is. I don't know what you need to stay out there on. I don't know what you need to stand your ground in, but I'm believing that as you endure, as you have a faith that endures, it's going to produce a confidence that is going to cause you to stay strong in purpose, stay strong in calling, stay strong in your strengths and gifts and all that God has called you to bring. I pray in this season where confidence is being shaken that we might have a stirring of faith. The fifth and the final thing is this. We are among those who have faith. We are among those who have faith. At the moment, Danny and I are in the midst of going through a program called Emotionally Healthy Relationships. In fact, there's a whole lot of courses around emotionally healthy spirituality and discipleship that are going to be really helpful for us as a church in this next season. And I can't wait for us to engage in some of these as a church and through our small groups in a way that I think is going to bring great fruit about in our lives. And the course that we're doing at the moment, one of the things that we need to complete, which I have never done, is a genogram of our family. And we're looking at our whole family. You're looking back a couple of generations, you're analyzing how your grandparents interrelated and how the connections between other families took place and where there was big moves and where there was great losses and how those things affected people. And when you start to map it all out on a page, it's sobering. It's sobering to think about the ways in which the behaviors and the values in our family can sometimes be repeated from generation to generation. We start to say things sometimes to ourselves like, well, my dad was like this and his dad was like this. And so, you know, my dad was an accountant and his dad was an accountant. So maybe. And my dad struggled with addiction and his dad struggled with addiction. So my dad struggled with anger and his dad was angry. And so we start to allow that narrative to control where we land in the way that we operate and behave. And certainly we know from the research that the kinds of behaviors of the generations past have the power to alter our bodies, alter our makeup at a cellular level, to leave us predisposed to certain kinds of behaviors ourselves. But we also must recognize that the choices and decisions that we make have the power to transform that for generations to come. And that we are also among those of faith. There is a lineage that we have in faith that we are now grafted into. And that's what the writer starts to draw their attention to. All this time he's saying, you, you, you. And now the writer starts to say, we. He's placing himself with these people and with their challenges and with their endurance and with their holding on to confidence. Now he's gone from saying, you did this to saying, we are going to endure. We are going to make it because we are among those of faith. It would be easy for them to think, well, are we among those of faith? Look at all these people drawing back, or they're drawing back. And he says, no, 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 no. You are of those who persevere in faith. The very next chapter, we go on to read about faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. We go on to read and understand the great history of faith and those who are faithful. And that's what the writer is saying. That's who you are among. You are among Abraham. You are among Isaac. You are among Jacob. You're among Rachel. You're among Rahab. You're among these people who with faith accomplished so much and in many ways didn't see everything come to pass, but were assured of it, saw it for future generations. That is faith. Faith is living in what we know to be a reality but might not yet be realized. Peter says this when Jesus asks him, who do people say that I am? And everyone came up with a few different ideas, and Jesus said then, who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And what he was speaking was faith. It was something that hadn't been fully realized, but something that he believed to be real. It was an affirmation of that. I pray in our lives that we would have the kind of faith that speaks out in confidence and acts out in faith what we know to be reality but might not yet be realized. What we know is kingdom but might not yet be completed. What we recognize is our calling and strength and gifting to bring to the table, even if it's not fully affirmed in every way we would hope. I pray that in this season where confidence is shaken, we would have a faith in something that can't be shaken. I pray that in this season where we are reevaluating what we are good at, whether we can bring something to the table, whether it is a part of our future, whether it can be something that we believe for, whether that's in our careers, whether that's in our relationships, where confidence can be shaken about whether we can operate and function in a relationship in a powerful way like we believe we're called to bring, where all of these aspects of our lives can be shaken in terms of our confidence. I pray that we would have a stirring of faith that would cause us to be able to hold on to our confidence. I want to take a moment today and pray for every person here. And maybe you find yourself connected with us and you know that there's a whole lot of things that have gone on in your life. And you come to a place where you recognize that you need to get your life right with God. The Bible challenges us, as we've been saying, that we need to make a decision to stop putting our faith in ourselves and in our own ability, and instead to put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and everything that He accomplished for us on that cross, through His life, through His death, through His resurrection. As we put our faith in Jesus, the Bible says that God Himself will come into our life. He'll forgive us of everything wrong we've ever done. He'll wipe the slate completely clean, give us a brand new start, remove the need for us to live under any kind of guilt or shame or condemnation. And if you're connected today and you know you need to make your peace with God, and we're going to pray a simple but a powerful prayer. Maybe it's a prayer for you and you're coming back to God. Maybe you grew up knowing about Him. Maybe you prayed at one stage. Maybe you went to a Christian school or a Sunday school. But if you're honest with yourself, you know that you have drifted away and there's a great disconnect between you and God's plan and God's purpose for your life. Or maybe you're connected today and you never had that kind of relationship, maybe you've never been to a church, but you recognize you need to make your peace with God, we're gonna pray a simple but a powerful prayer. Why don't you pray this with me? Let's pray together. Dear God, right now, I give you my life. I stop living my own way. I want to follow you. Come and be my Lord and my Savior and my greatest friend. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, can we celebrate that decision? Could we rejoice over the decision that people are making? If you did make that decision, if you did pray that prayer, if you are committing afresh your life to the Lord Jesus, then we'd love to empower you in any way that we can as a church to continue to step up into all that God has for you. We'd love to connect with you, and maybe if we can, place you in an environment where people are going to be able to encourage you in all that God has for you. And so if you did pray that prayer, if you did make that decision today, would you do us a favor? Would you text the name Jesus to 84,000, and our team will be able to connect with you and do anything we can to help you keep stepping up into all that He has for you. I want to pray again once more for anyone here, and you just know that your confidence is being shaken. I want to pray that there would be a stirring of faith, and that confidence would rise, and that you would have a confidence in what God is doing and a confidence in all that you are called to bring about in terms of kingdom come and in terms of the gifting that has been placed upon your life. Let's pray together. And then we're going to worship. Why don't you linger with us? Thank you for joining us today. We love you. Believing for you to have an incredible week as you step out into all that God has for you. Keep looking out for emails and socials on all the gatherings that are going to be taking place over these next few weeks as we head into Thanksgiving and as we head into Christmas. And let's keep praying and believing as a community over what we might be able to contribute as we move towards half of the house. But let me pray for us. Let's pray for confidence that this week there might be a change in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that you are for us, that you are good, that you do exercise good judgment. And Lord, we pray that even now, you would come, you would grace us to have confidence again, a confidence grounded in the right things, a faith in all that you are doing, in the age to come, in what you are giving to us, in the compassion we can have for those around us. Lord, let confidence rise again where it's been challenged, where it's been shaken. Lord, grace us to have confidence again that would see us move forward into all that you have for us, that would see us move forward into all that you have gifted us with. Holy Spirit, come. Come and lead us into all truth. Come and invade our reality in whatever space and place we find ourselves in. Come and affirm once again our strengths and all that you've called us to bring to the table. Help us to be a blessing as a result. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's linger in worship for a moment. We love you, church.
You love us never gonna give up. He never gave up. He never gave up on me. You love us never gonna give up. He never gave up. He never gave up on me. You love
doing